During the Cold War, Hanford built 6 more reactors along the Columbia River and raised the power levels of the 3 earlier reactors to produce more plutonium. The waters from the Columbia River were used to cool the reactors and prevent them from overheating. Michelle Gerber details the impacts Hanford's reactors had as they dumped radioactive, toxic, and extremely hot water into the Columbia River.
Hanford's problem with the Columbia River began very soon after World War II. In World War II, yes, reactor effluent or cooling water that had been through the reactors was channeled to the Columbia River. But we don't find very much effect. There's not zero effect, but not much effect. It's after the Cold War begins, and they're building more reactors. And they're also raising the power levels of the reactors that they already have built. And that essentially means pushing more cooling water through. And so in the late 1940s is when the river effects become quite noticeable. And they're noticeable because the staff of the biology operation at Hanford is growing. They're doing their due diligence. They're measuring the water, the fish, the mud, all the parts of the river. And by the summer of 1947, which isn't very long into the process, they're already saying, gee, the levels are double what they were last year in certain parts of the river or certain patches of mud. And by 1949, you know, wow, now they're 3 or 4 times what they were. And by the mid-1950s and the late 1950s, you're getting exponential. I mean exponential in that a sample of a fish might be 50 times what it was. It might be 100,000 times what it was in World War II. And so the problems in the river are getting severe. There's also chemical contamination. Reactors, you know, there's chemicals added to the water, but the main problem comes because the water, the process tubes that hold the water will develop a film over time. And you have to purge off that film, you have to scrape it, rinse it off, or it will interfere with the fission reaction. And so you would have to add purge chemicals and sometimes particulates to the cleaning water, the cooling water, run it through the reactor to purge the film off the tubes, and out would come an array of chemicals into the river. And as the reactors operated hotter and with more water, the film developed faster, and you were at the point by the mid-1950s that you're having to purge a reactor every month. In some cases in the early 1960s, more than once a month per reactor. And so you're having a huge chemical burden introduced to the river. In some cases, the site scientists would say in their secret reports, the chemical burden is almost worse than the radiological burden. So you have that. Of course, it's all classified. The public is not being told. The third problem is heat. Of course, the reactor water enters from the river at about, I'm going to say a year-round average, of 50 to 70 degrees. And it's going to come out up to almost the boiling point. In fact, over the years, the Atomic Energy Commission raised the exit water temperature limits over and over, to the point that by 1962, the operating limit was, as long as the water didn't flash to steam, it could come out at 1 to 1/2 degree below boiling. So it's coming out very hot. And by this time also, you've got more water, less capacity to retain it, to cool it off before it goes back. It's going into the river, sometimes only 30 minutes after it came out of the reactor. So it hasn't cooled very much. By the early 1960s, the heat load was such that the reactors, they were afraid, were going to have to shut down in the summer. they couldn't even operate because of the heat load in the water. So they developed a secret plan with the Department of the Interior that runs Grand Coulee Dam to release large quantities in mass from Lake Roosevelt, which is the upstream side of the Grand Coulee Dam, and flush that, flush cold water down through the Hanford Reach so that the reactors could continue to run all summer long.